back on this thing about the reports. The business meeting is October 8th. Make sure that you're aware of that, put it down on your calendar. I've had so many things people want announced that I'm kind of flustered here. So start with, Linda has something to say for the owls. We want to go ahead, Linda, and do that.
Okay, I just want to remind you that while I'm coming a week from this Friday, that's the 11th, Stormy Oak, please sign up back there. We want to make sure we have enough for the week for everybody.
Okay, so.
And also, we are going to be ordering t-shirts and sweatshirts again. So we'll have more information on the 11th. So bring your checkbooks or your cash. Sweatshirt or t-shirt.
The other thing that we have is if you look back in the back, there's a chair back by that table. Diane has got information on padded chairs for us to look at. So before you leave, if you're interested in the chair, make sure you sit down on that thing and see if you like it or not. And there's material back there and some other stuff, and I'm sure there'll be more to come for that in the coming days. Make sure you look at the announcement for men on the 19th, and there's things for Operation Christmas Child and other stuff. And it's just like I said, your bulletin is just full of things that everybody needs to be aware of. And I'm not going to read through all that, so take your time, not during the sermon, and look through that. So anyway, if you would stand up, let's go ahead and open it first. Let's pray. Our dear Father, Lord, we just thank you for the opportunity to come to your house. Lord, we just want to glorify you in all that we do. We just ask that you help us to worship you in a manner that you're worthy. And Lord, be with Brother Mike as he brings the message, that he would tell us things that you would want us to hear, and that we would apply it to our lives and be better servants for you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Remain standing. Let's sing together to the glory of God. We're going to sing My Savior's Love, but there's an interesting thing. I didn't know which verse to leave out, so we're singing all four verses. So I hope you're ready. Here we go. I didn't enjoy that. I didn't like weightlifting. I didn't like long distance runs. And I didn't like the wind sprints. We call them kill drills. I especially did not like the kill drills. All of the discipline and all of the conditioning, all of that was necessary. Why? To make us a good team. To make us a good team, all of the discipline, all of the conditioning was necessary. But I didn't enjoy that part of the game. You see, I didn't enjoy it until they put a basketball in my hand. But discipline makes the difference. When I was in school, one year we had a lazy coach. And you can imagine what our team was like the year we had the lazy coach. There was no long distance running to get in shape. A few wind sprints here and there, but very little discipline. And our preparation showed. We won 2 games all season long. Now, the next year, we had a different coach, but we had exactly the same team, man to man. Exactly the same team. We played the same competition. This coach believed in conditioning. For 6 weeks leading up to our first practice, we ran 2 or 3 miles a day, followed by wind sprints, lots of them. And once we got into the season, he wanted to make sure that we practiced our free throws, so for every free throw the whole team missed, the whole team got to run a wind sprint, a kill drill. And we had to finish the kill drills in 30 seconds or it didn't count. So if we had a bad free throw night where we missed 15 free throws as a team, we were dead tired the next day at the end of practice. We lifted weights in the weight room 3 times a week during our conditioning. Now, the same team who had won 2 games the previous season only lost 4 games that season. And it all had to do with discipline. It all had to do with condition. The difference was that conditioning even made us look like basketball players. So let me apply this same principle to us running the race of life. The writer of the book of Hebrews said that we needed to run with patience the race that is set before us. But yet he goes on to describe an element of conditioning. He said, we run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus the whole time. Why? Because he is the author and the finisher of our faith. He is our example. And he chose to endure the pain of the cross as an example to us, so that we could see the benefit of how to walk with God. So, I want you to remember that life is a long race. It's a lifetime. There are challenges along the way. There are setbacks along the way. Sometimes you might even feel like you're coasting. And sometimes you might even feel as if the wind is at your back. Sometimes, some days, it's easier than others, and then other days it's very, very difficult. But nonetheless, we need to remember that it is a long race, a lifetime. Which brings me to the first point I want to share with you today. As a Christian, we cannot patiently endure running the race of life without Christian conditioning and Christian discipline. Christian discipline. Christian condition? What on earth is that?
Well, I think all of you know, but the bottom line is it has to do with you being acquainted with God's Word. It has to do that you be acquainted with the Holy Spirit of God through your prayer life to Him, to the point that you even hear Him impress on your heart some of the big decisions you need to make in life. And if you never open your Bible, if you never read the verse of the day on your Bible app that many of you have on your phones, if you never do any of that stuff, then here today is the only time that you've opened up and you say, God, I'm ready, speak to me. But I want to just share with you today, even if you have a Bible app on your phone and you open up that Bible app to the point that you know what your verse of the day is and you're able to hold that verse in your heart, it's amazing how even at that, God will communicate with you. There are some of you that read the Bible through in a year. And for those of you who don't know, that's approximately 3 chapters a day. It's all you would have to do. You know, it's approximately about 12 minutes a day of slowly reading through those 3 chapters. And it's amazing how far your life will go whenever you do that type of conditioning and that type of discipline. There are some of you who even get the devotional book, the Daily Breads, and you read your devotion every single day because you see a benefit in that. That is what Christian conditioning and Christian discipline looks like. Once our Christian lives have the conditioning and the discipline needed to endure, we begin to acknowledge more victories in our lives than losses. The conditioning in your life, get this, it'll even make you look like a Christian. It'll even make you look like a Christian. You know, it's amazing from 1 year to the next. The first year, whenever we had the coach who was lazy, during that particular year, I got to tell you, people weren't afraid to play us. We didn't even look like basketball players warming up and doing our layups and doing those sorts of things to begin with. We did not look like basketball players. But we were in such incredible physical condition that the very next year, we were a different team. The same guys, the same players, but we looked and we played differently. I want to tell you what, whenever we were doing our warm-up drills before a game, the other team had an idea that they might be in trouble. They had an idea they might be in trouble because we looked like ball players. I want you to know that if you are practicing these elements that I have discussed with you, I want you to know that people will see from a mile away that you look like a Christian. You look like a Christian. Let me take this analogy just a little bit further, and then we'll read our scripture for today. When we accept Jesus, now let me personalize it. When you accept Jesus, you accept His cross. That's what I want you to grasp and understand today. When we accept Jesus, we accept His cross. And it makes sense that we trust the truth that Jesus died for our sins. We believe that. We sing about it on Sundays. We trust the truth that Jesus died for our sins when He died on the cross. But if that's all you think, you're not taking this far enough. On the day that we accept Jesus into our lives, accept his cross, on that day we're not really in any real shape to carry that cross a long distance. And that's where our Christian conditioning and discipline come in. I want us to look at Mark chapter 8, beginning in verse 34. Jesus says, "When he had called the people to himself with his disciples also, he said to them, 'Whoever desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? Or what will a man give in exchange for his soul? For whoever is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with his holy angels.'" Now notice, Jesus is teaching, he's making a statement to both his disciples and the other onlookers who happen to be present. And he said that the key to successful Christian living, the key to being able to enjoy your Christian life, comes when you deny yourself. I think it does. Because the scripture tells us in so many different passages that whenever we deny ourselves and follow Jesus, it is the step that we're taking toward abundant life. Toward abundant life. Let me give you an illustration before I go further into the scripture. Let me give you an illustration that clears up this passage of scripture. This week, Kathy and I bought a new desk for my office at home. Now, it wasn't assembled, so it fit in the back of my car in a heavy box. Now, Kathy knew she couldn't help me get the box in the house. So she asked me, she said, "Are you going to ask Carl to help you?" And Carl, I guess I could have, but then I wouldn't have this illustration today, would I? So, I knew what to do. I went into the house and I got the desk chair. Wasn't any arms on this desk chair. And so all I had to do was slide that box out and stand it up on this desk chair and steer the chair into the house. I couldn't have carried the box by myself. But I got to tell you, it was quite easy whenever I let the desk chair support the weight. And whenever you take up your cross, whenever you deny yourself and you take up your cross, not Jesus' cross, but your cross to carry the weight, I want you to understand that it's kind of like that desk chair. It supports the weight. Whenever you're in the will of God, if you can imagine that the cross supports your weight, we don't have to do the heavy lifting in life. If Jesus carried the weight of the world on his shoulders, I promise you, he can carry you. However, we do have to carry our cross. And so Jesus is giving us an invitation to life. And this this invitation is to truly live. This invitation is not just to exist. This invitation is not just to breathe. But you have the opportunity to live life as it was meant to be lived. Listen carefully. God's invitation to life comes through death. Jesus' death on the cross. Now, it says we're to take up our cross by denying ourselves. So in other words, we're no longer first place in our lives. Our priority is we are faced with our priority, and that is God and His Son, Jesus. Now, I want to give you a very dramatic image today. We have this tendency in church and in our world today. You know, we are 2,000 years removed from Jesus dying on the cross. And I think that somehow or another, over the years, in our minds, Christians have cleaned up that image of carrying the cross. We look at crosses as nice. We look at the cross as a sweet religious symbol. We look at the cross as something you can put on a chain and put around your neck, and it looks so nice. But that's not how the early church viewed carrying your cross. The cross was the Roman symbol of death. And it was a death that was given to you by execution. And so whenever Jesus said that we are to not deny ourselves and take up the cross, we need to understand that the cross is pictured as a gruesome thing. And that would be somewhat necessary for us to understand how gruesome our sins were. For how gruesome our sins actually were. Originally, the cross was an instrument of torture. The cross meant this. The cross meant humiliation. The cross meant pain. The cross meant suffering. And the cross meant death. And it's interesting that we have taken up, as Christians, the symbol of the cross. And so, at first glance, the cross should represent your remorse and your sorrow and your humiliation for your sins. The cross should represent the pain that you suffered as a result of your sins. And the cross in your mind and in your imagination, it should represent how it cost Jesus His life. He died so that you could live. And back in Jesus' day, even before Jesus went to the cross, the disciples had an instant mental image of how the cross was to be perceived. And it wasn't a pleasant one. So, don't get me wrong, I know that our lives today, we have hard moments in our lives. And I even know that following Jesus isn't always easy. And I'm not standing before you today promising anyone a pain-free or trouble-free life if they follow Jesus. But I don't think that Jesus is saying that life in His service is always going to be horrible. He's actually giving us an invitation to abundant living, abundant life, and it's found in discovering our purpose and discovering God's plan. But the key is always found in our spiritual exercise. is found in our discipline. The key is found in conditioning our ways and our thoughts to match God's ways and God's thoughts. We access the abundant life by giving up control of ourselves. So the very point in this passage of Scripture, it's not what we do for Jesus. It's what He does for you. Once you trust Him completely. It's what He does for your mindset. It's what He does in your spirit and in your heart. Once you trust Him completely. And we follow Jesus because, quite frankly, He is the source of our life. Now, I want you to understand that right before Jesus made this statement that we are to take up our cross, we are to deny ourselves and take up our cross and follow Him. In the verses preceding this, Jesus tells His disciples that He's going to face death. And whenever Peter rebuked Jesus told Peter, He said, "Get behind me, Satan." Can you imagine? Jesus called Peter Satan. He said, "Get behind me, Satan." Now, why did He call him that in that moment? Peter was not even grasping the direction that God was leading Jesus in this moment. Peter was still searching for his own way. And Peter's own way was not a pleasant way for him to go. Jesus said, "Get behind me, Satan, because you don't understand. You don't have in your mind the things of God. You're only thinking the way a human being would think. You're only thinking the way you want that. You're going to have to deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me." History records that Peter did take up his cross one day later. That he was indeed crucified. Legend has it that it was Peter that made the suggestion. But anyway, he said he wasn't worthy to die in the same manner that his Lord did. So legend says that they actually crucified Peter upside down. They crucified him upside down. So Peter did learn this lesson. Now I want to bring this back to us for a moment. Jesus doesn't ask you to take up His cross. He carried the whole weight of the world on His shoulders when He carried His cross. He's not asking you to carry His cross. He's asking you to carry your cross. Jesus doesn't say that you're going to have to die on your cross. He just says you've got to carry it. And when we carry our cross, we gain the benefits of the cross. Jesus is encouraging to us. He's encouraging us to identify with His death and His resurrection because He is the source of abundant and satisfying life and living. He's calling us to stop focusing on ourselves and instead stay focused on Him. He's asking us to lose our lives in the sense that we become so wrapped up in Him that we no longer think of our own wants and desires. Now, for those who are listening to Jesus, that phrase, "take up your cross," let me tell you what it meant. It brought to mind a Roman custom. And we know this Roman custom because we know Jesus walked the way of the Via Dolorosa. And we have even heard songs about the Via Della Rosa. But as far as the Romans were concerned, they had a custom. And it was called the death walk. And the death walk was at whenever a criminal who was condemned to die by crucifixion, he was required to carry his cross to his place of execution. Now, if the criminal was physically unable to carry the cross, maybe because of the torture he had already received, those officers, those Roman officers who were leading the execution, they would often compel somebody who was in the crowd, an innocent bystander, to carry the cross. And so, Jesus himself didn't carry his cross very far. His cross was carried by an innocent bystander. Someone who was randomly and inconveniently compelled to carry Jesus' cross. I think we need to read the story in Mark chapter 15, verse 22. Verse 20 through 22. In Mark chapter 15, beginning in verse 20, it says, "And when they had mocked him, they took the purple off him, put his own clothes on him, and led him out to crucify him. Then they compelled a certain man, Simon, a Cyrenian, the father of Alexander and Rufus." Now remember that. "They compelled a certain man, Simon a Cyrenian, the father of Alexander and Rufus, as he was coming out of the country and just passing by, to bear his cross, and they brought him to the place called Golgotha." Now, we don't know a lot about Simon. The incident is recorded in three of the four Gospels. But what we do know about Simon is he was from Cyrene. That's in northern Africa. Now, if Simon was a believer, it is likely that he was there for the Passover and for business. It's not likely that he would have come just for one. He was there for the Passover and for business, and he had traveled a long way. He probably had planned on concluding his business, celebrating the Passover, and then heading home. This was not a Jewish man. This was a proselyte. His schedule did not include stopping to watch the crucifixion of Jesus. The Bible made it clear he was simply a passerby. And suddenly he heard from a Roman soldier who was summoning him to carry Jesus' cross. Put yourself in Simon's shoes. Think just for a moment. Simon thought, "Are you serious? Are you serious? Why me? Why do I need to carry the cross?" I mean, talk about inconvenience. And his boys were right there. He probably even thought to himself, "Who is this beaten man? Whoever it is, he sure seems to be hated and despised." So as Simon walks between the gallery of people, he listens to them as they are spitting and cursing Jesus' name. Simon probably even thought, "I don't even know this guy." And as he began to carry Jesus' cross, he probably thought to himself, "Don't spit on me. Don't throw things at me. I'm a businessman. I'm in town from Africa. This is none of my business. I don't deserve to carry a cross." Ah, right there. Sometimes we think, "Lord, I don't deserve to carry this cross." Sometimes in our spirit, we too complain. We say, Lord, I don't deserve this. I don't deserve to carry my cross. Why do I feel singled out by the crowd? But we like our schedules, don't we? But I want you to listen to this last point. Sometimes God's interruptions turn out to be the most meaningful moments of our lives. Did you hear that? Sometimes God's interruptions, whenever we turn to Him in faith believing, sometimes God's interruptions turn out to be the most meaningful moments of our lives. When Jesus calls you to carry your cross, it means that you trust Him. You trust Him with everything. You're trusting Jesus. Whenever you're carrying your cross, you're trusting Jesus with your schedule, your plans, your priorities, your goals. And you trust Jesus even when it inconveniences you. You know, we can be so obsessed with the funny little plans we make. We need to learn to welcome God's inconveniences. We need to learn to welcome even God's interruptions. In Proverbs 16:9, the Bible says, "A man's heart plans his way, but the Lord directs his steps." Now, from the perspective of history, when Simon carried Jesus' cross, it's all that's said about Simon, this particular Simon. And so, as far as history is concerned, that was Simon's greatest achievement. It's what he's known for. The Bible doesn't talk about what happened to Simon after this incident. But interestingly enough, Mark is the only gospel that records the names of his two children. Now, I want to remind you that at the day of Jesus' execution, at the day of his crucifixion, Mark would have been a teenage boy about 14 years old who had witnessed a lot at the Last Supper. But yet, Rufus and Alexander are mentioned. Apparently, Mark knew them or came to know them. And there are some Bible scholars that believe that these two young men would later become well-known figures in the Christian community that Mark was now writing to. His gospel was written to the Gentiles, you know. And if this was true, whenever Simon carried Jesus' cross, this was a life-changing event for Rufus and Alexander. They watched as their dad carried the cross of Jesus, and it made a difference in their lives. And your children and your grandchildren may be watching you carry your cross. What type of an impact will that make on your children, your grandchildren? What type of an impact will that make on your friends and on your neighbors? There was a song that I heard yesterday at the conference that I attended, a song that we sing here, and it's one of our video songs, and I'm going to ask all of you to stand right now, and I want us to be able to celebrate this living hope together, the living hope that impacted Rufus and Alexander. The living hope that impacted a young teenage boy by the name of Mark. But we want to sing this song to the glory of the Lord because we have a living hope here today when we carry the cross of Jesus Christ. So let's sing together, and if there are any of you who feel the need to come forward and pray, won't you come? Mm-hmm.
give, Kathy and I, we're going to slip out really quickly because it involves our grandkids. We need to be someplace by 1:15. So we got a long way to drive. So anyway, let's pray together. Thank you, Father, for this day. Lord, thank you for your Spirit flowing through this place. Thank you for the way that you've touched our lives and encouraged our hearts. Be with us as we leave here today. Strengthen us as we seek to serve you. Help us to take up our cross, dear Father, and serve you, understanding that this invitation, dear Father, is the way to abundant life, not only in heaven, but here on earth as well. Bless us, we pray, in Christ's name. Amen. God bless you.